joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jagro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Wilson Cole. Wilson is CEO and founder of Adams, Evans & Rust, the nation's largest credit and collection firm that works exclusively for staffing and recruiting. For almost 30 years, AER has processed over $1 billion in staffing and recruiting debt for more than 3,500 staffing and recruiting companies. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Wilson breaks down the five things you should do right now regarding your credit and collections and company finances to prepare your business after COVID. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to share your feedback. With that, I will turn the floor over to Wilson.
Well, thank you kindly. I appreciate you guys having me on today. I'm assuming you can hear me fine. So let's go ahead and what I'm going to talk about and what I've been talking about to all of our clients is what you need to be doing right now. As this webinar is being recorded, it's mid-November. Sounds like we're about to go through the last big whammy of COVID, and the vaccine is on the horizon. So my hope would be that in the next 120 days, certainly by the end of first quarter, second quarter, I think things will start resembling a little more normal than they've been. You've got an opportunity to set the stage for some future growth into 2021. The issue is, in my opinion, the danger has never been what's going to happen to small businesses that are in the staffing industry during COVID, especially over on the staffing side. Direct hires in some industries have taken a hit. I realize the hospitality industry, stick a fork in them, they're done for a while. But what's going to happen in second quarter and probably third quarter is I think the money supply is going to tighten up. And we've seen this will be the fourth recession that we've been through. The government, regardless where you feel on politics, and I'm the most center, will avoid politics to save my life, and think they both have crazy ideas and good ideas. But one thing from a financial standpoint that the government did do was they injected a ton of cash about the time we went into lockdown. I know most of the staffing firms that are sitting here on the call probably received a tremendous amount of PPP money. There's also some additional funds and things on those lines that are available that I want to talk to you about. Something that I do want to mention to you and certainly check with your own tax provider, but right now, and this is unrelated to the webinar, but I think it's important enough for everybody to know going into the end of the year, the IRS made a ruling, and what they are saying is, and hopefully when Congress reconvenes and passes a stimulus bill, they will address this problem, because the PPP funds were sent out to small businesses so they wouldn't lay off the staff, and it was not to be treated as income, so i.e. not a taxable event. The IRS has basically said, yep, it's not income, but you're not able to write off the expenses that you spent the money on. So whenever you have a taxable event, you treat it as income. If you have a deduction, you write it off. What they're basically saying is the money that they sent to you, you're not going to be able to write off those expenses, which in essence is going to make it a taxable event, and it's going to be something that in 2020 you'll have to address if you get forgiveness, even if you get forgiveness in 2021. That is, in my opinion, not the intent that Congress had. They wanted this money to go out to small businesses to where, in essence, it was cheaper than the unemployment that was about to head their way. But check with your tax professionals. It's still very fluid, but whatever you've gotten in, you probably want to at least plan worst case scenario as far as on taxes. So a little bit of a bait and switch there as far as I'm concerned on the government. But what I want to talk to you about today is what you need to be doing to prepare for future growth, but also for when the money supply tightens up. So what, you know, a lot of you guys are familiar with PPP, and I just wound up trashing, you know, what's coming down with the bait and switch with PPP. But even at that, and hopefully it gets resolved, the COVID loans are still out there. And basically, the government has a loan program that is out that they offer. It's typically for, like, if a hurricane hits, you know, Gulf Shores, Alabama, Pensacola, Mobile, New Orleans, or whatever. Those small businesses that have been affected, maybe they were washed away. It's going to be 6 months or a year before it gets back up. The government will come in and offer disaster loans or economic disaster relief loans. They refer to them short as EIDL loans. And typically an SBA loan, if you were to go borrow from just an SBA lender or get an SBA loan, it's typically you pay 20% down. They'll finance it out over 7, maybe 10 years if there's property involved. And it's roughly at about somewhere between 6 and 8% interest. These EIDL loans are pretty much capped at $150,000, and it's per IEN number. So, and with this being said, I have no issue to tell you we applied and received one for all four of our companies here because it's insanely cheap money, and I'll explain why I think that's going to be a problem going forward if you don't have access to cheap loans. And I'm not a loan guy. We've been in business 30 years. The last 20 years we've been self-funded. But these particular loans are 3.75% interest financed out over 30 years. And the government, and they're going to save the paperwork, but the government has waived personal guarantees for up to for the first $200,000. If it's over $200,000, there's personal guarantees. If it's under $200,000, it's secured by the business assets, but it's not personally guaranteed. So if you think about that for just a half a second, if you're a small business, if you go and borrow money from anywhere, whether it's a bank, whether it's a lender, I can assure you they've got a UCC-1, which makes them a secured creditor, which the SBA is going to do on anything above $25,000, but they probably have personal guarantees. The fact that you can get up to $150,000 per IEN number, not per owner, per IEN number. Now, if all those IEN numbers flow in to one corporation, I think there's going to be some delineation there. But if you have a staffing firm, let's say, set up in California, and you have another one in Arizona, and they file their own tax returns, then those are their own IEN numbers. And so you would be eligible up to the $150,000. I recommend that you go ahead and get them. I can tell you the first one that we received back in May probably took about 8 weeks. The last one that we received in August, literally from the point when we filed the process that they were depositing the funds, was about 8 days. So they've got this thing on autopilot. I know these disaster loans are going to be pulled or they'll run out of money eventually, but there's not going to be an opportunity to be able to get non-personally guaranteed loans and with 30-year financing at 3.75%. And the issue that you're going to run, let me jump over here real quick. The reason why I want you to consider these loans, now if you're sitting with tons of cash in, then it's not an issue. But typically 3.75%, I think ours is sitting in a in a bond fund, a treasury bond fund, and we're earning about the same. So it's literally at this point being free money. So, you know, if you were looking at expanding your business, now there's certain things that you can do, certain things that you cannot do. You can't take the money and go put a pool in the back of your house. You have to use it as operating capital, but you don't have to go through that money right now. It can be sitting in a bank, use it over the next 5 to 10 years. But if there was ever a time that you wanted to expand your business, right now would be the time to do it. And the government, in essence, is going to back you on it, and you're not personally guaranteed. Now, the reason that I basically say the money supply is going to dry up. Right now, we're at roughly 0% interest. The only way that in the old days, in the 80s and in the 90s, and even in the 2000s, to speed up or slow down the economy, they would raise interest rates. It would slow the economy down. They drop interest rates. Everybody's out buying cars, houses, and it speeds it up. That's how they controlled inflation. Well, what they do now, since we're at zero, the only thing they can do is inject money into the system and pull money back out. And my concern is once this is over and whatever this is, I don't think it's going to end in, you know, the first quarter, but I think once you start getting into the second and third quarter, you're going to see the government start pulling a lot of this money back out of the economy, and you're going to find it more difficult to borrow money. Now, small businesses, you know, I always, you know, whenever there's a new entrepreneur and they come to me and ask my advice and they say, I've got a business plan and I'm going to go to the bank and show it to them to go borrow money, I don't ever have the heart to tell them, because who knows, maybe they'll find somebody to do it. But I've never gone to a bank where if you had an where if you didn't have an asset, the bank would loan you money based on an idea. I've just never found it in 30 years. What they'll typically do is if you have, you know, a piece of property that's worth $500,000, they'll loan you up to $400,000 on it. If you're a really good customer, maybe they'll loan you up to 90% on it. But that is the old tradition, but just money itself is going to be a little bit more difficult. This is going to trickle down to your clients because, you know, you may be sitting in wonderful financial shape, but you may also have clients that aren't. Also, if you have clients that owe you money, you know, one thing that we have used is we've recommended these EIDL loans to debtors. And I can tell you there's been about 20 to 25 debtors that have paid our clients ranging anywhere from, you know, a couple of $1,000 up to $90,000, $95,000 on debts that they were able to get these EIDL loans. So if you have companies that you have a good relationship with your clients, you may want to mention that to them. If you have a debtor that's struggling, refer them over to these EIDL loans in within 2 or 3 weeks, loans that they wouldn't have qualified for in any form or fashion a year and a half ago. They probably would wind up, if they're a legitimate business, they've been filing tax returns. And I want to say the credit scoring on it's like 650, 660. It's a relatively low credit score to be eligible for it. Use those COVID loans, even if you're not going to use them for yourself, use it as a collection tool. The other thing that I want you to do right now, if you have a new client that hasn't utilized you in a while, make sure definitely you pull out their you pull their credit. If it is a client that just comes in out of nowhere, make sure you pull their credit. One of the things I know with Tricom and a lot of other funding companies is they pull credit, and so you have a little bit of that already covered. But one thing that I would insist on if I were sitting on your side of the desk, because you're still on the hook for it, if they don't pay Tricom or another funding company, you're still on the hook for it, is if it's a company that hasn't, you know, if their payments are starting to slack back or if they haven't utilized you in a while, I would go ahead and pull credit. And I would actually go and take a look at all of your clients and start kind of categorizing them to see who you need to go back and kind of prep for. Now, as you take a look at your clients, the third one that I want you to do is based on the company size and structure, go back and check credit and be a little bit more, for lack of a better word, a little bit more diligent on it. If they're A-size companies, these are going to be large publicly traded companies. You know, the chances of not getting paid are pretty slim. Yes, there could be companies that go bankrupt. We've had some public companies go bankrupt, especially over on the retail side, this go around, but it's just not as likely. Those you don't have to worry about. That just becomes a credit risk and also a cash flow issue on how much you want to extend out. The other size of the companies or the other companies are B-size companies. These are companies that that are going to be basically decent-sized regional companies. These may be companies that, you know, are a dealership with, you know, three or four or five locations, a local grocery store chain or things along those lines. You still need to check their credit, but you don't need to be as diligent every 6 months. What I'm talking about when I say check credit, I'm saying on C-size companies, you need to be re-reviewing their credit every 6 to 12 months. Small companies represent half of the workforce here, and in my opinion, small businesses under 500 people, most of them are probably under 50 to 100, can be amazingly profitable. The problem that you run into is, let's assume you had a company that, you know, the owner and his wife are running the business. They've got 50 employees, and they've been utilizing, let's say, 20 of your folks in whatever, you know, facility they have. If they had lost a client through COVID, their financial situation could be greatly reduced. Or let's assume, and this is why I was mentioning with the PPP funds, let's assume they were able to get, you know, $300,000 out of PPP. And let's assume the Congress doesn't address where you're not able to write off the expenses on it, and it becomes, in essence, a taxable event. You know, on average, just using round math, that $300,000 becomes a $60,000 tax bill that they may not realize that they now owe. And so they may misjudge cash flow, or let's say the owners get divorced, or let's say the mom and dad decide, you know what, we've done this for 30 years, we're going to go down to Florida or wherever the heck they want to retire to, and they pass it on to their kids. Now, I've been in business 30 years. I have some of my children working with me, and we are positioning them in a position in the next 10 years to take over the company, and hopefully everything flows out the way that it should. And I know a lot of our clients have their second generations coming in, but a lot of companies, if the successors haven't been trained right, all of a sudden the company just becomes a piggy bank for that next generation, and they run it into the ground. My point being is C-size companies are dependent on what's going on with the owner's principal life. You know, I mean, you can have a CEO of Google get divorced, you know, three times, as children come in and start, you know, helping with the company. It's not going to affect the financials of anything because they're so big and there's so much money already primed in. Small businesses aren't immune to poor decisions. You know, I tell a lot of the business owners that I deal with is you're typically only two or three really bad decisions from being out of business. And so, and I'm an optimistic guy, but if you extend, you know, $400,000 to the wrong company, and that is going to put your company at risk, then you need to know, you know, where those limits are. And we're going to get into, you know, as far as on credit lines here in a minute, but C-size companies are the ones that you constantly want to check. Also, here over the next, you know, 6 weeks or so, as you gear up for the expansion that's going to happen. You know, there's no doubt in my mind that once COVID is over, things are going to pick up. Everybody's going to be celebrating life and doing all of the stuff that they need to be doing. And business should, you know, if you're in the staffing, whether it's direct hire or temporary, I think business is about to get really, really good for everybody. Go ahead and pull an inventory of your contracts. You know, make sure that you have all the paperwork and things along those lines. You know, I can't tell you how many times we get in an account that, you know, runs through collections. We send it out to the attorneys for suit. You know, 84% of the time we collect it. That's some good news. Bad news is 1 out of 8 we don't. And we, you know, that 1 out of 8 we have to sue. And then we get ready to go out to court, and the client's really not sure of the proper legal name of the company. And I know it sounds like semantics, but just using, for example, you know, even if it's a franchise like McDonald's, it's typically not McDonald's that owes you the funds. It may be Joe Smith Holdings doing business as McDonald's. You need to know what it is and who it is that you're dealing with as far as their proper name. Make sure you have the timesheet signed. And, you know, a lot of times our clients that are in the staffing industry, they may have a direct hire agreement. Go ahead and get some of those resigned. You know, in your timesheets, you typically have a conversion fee, and each time that they sign it, that does help. But go ahead and pull an inventory of everything that you need to have online. Now, the last thing that I want you to do is have some type of stop loss triggers set up. You know, I have clients call me all the time and they say, you know, Wilson, this is one that slipped through the cracks. We don't typically extend this much credit, but, you know, I took my eye off the ball and now they owe me $78,000, you know. And we pull up the credit on this company, and there is no way I would have loaned them $780, much less $78,000. And you've got a nice backdrop with Tricom because they are pulling those credit, setting the credit lines for you. But you may want to do that as far as well, because somebody today may be a $50,000 credit risk, but let's say they get a divorce, and if you're not rechecking credit, let's say they're only a good $5,000 credit risk. But the opposite of that is true, is you may set up somebody and they're, you know, a great $5,000 credit risk, but a horrible $50,000 credit risk. So make sure that you have something that once a customer gets beyond their limit. If you say, you know what, I'm going to give everybody, you know, the first $10,000, I'm not going to worry about, they can have that. But you know what, I want a little deeper credit application. I maybe want to become a secured creditor at $50,000. And just as a side note, on a secured creditor, the only difference between a secured creditor and a non-secured creditor is getting an agreement signed. And you can typically bury it in your employment contract or on your terms and conditions that gives you the ability to file a UCC-1. In a UCC-1, you send to the county courthouse where the debtor is located, and you become a secured creditor. That secured creditor aspect doesn't ensure that you're going to get paid, but they cannot sell the business without paying you off. How many times has companies changed hands and they say, oh, it was the new owners or the old owners that owe you, new owners don't. This would have stopped that. Secondly, if a company files for bankruptcy, if you've ever gotten a notice, they'll show, you know, a whole novel of unsecured creditors, but the secured creditors may be a list of 2 or 3, and it's always going to be a bank. Or a funding company. They follow the processes when loaning money. And I actually won't, you know, and I've tried to preach this to all of our staffing clients, especially recruiting or direct hire slightly different, but you need to look at it as you're not only supplying staff, you're really loaning money. And if somebody were to pick up the phone and call you and say, hey, I'm a great guy, loan me 10 grand and I'll pay you back in 30 days. Here's a couple of people I paid. You'd hang up the phone, you'd walk down the hallway, and you'd laugh with everybody about, you know, the crazy guy that called you on the phone. Unfortunately, you do that every time that a new client calls in and you don't check their credit. And, you know, if I always recommend you check it two ways. One is, you know, pull a Dun & Bradstreet and Experian. We have a product called Credit Screen, which will let you know how they pay their institutionalized creditors. It will also let you know how they pay their primary, you know, creditors. Staffing and recruiting firms don't ever report to Dun & Bradstreet. When was the last time that you picked up the phone and said, hey, somebody's paying me 90 days? You don't. No one does. Dun & Bradstreet's good on the institutional side, and then also if they have any tax liens or any lawsuits. You typically show up as a creditor in lawsuits when your debtor doesn't pay you and we have to have them sued. I still recommend that you get three trades in a bank on the old-fashioned credit application, because those three trade references in the bank will help you internally set what those credit lines should be. If somebody's wanting a $50,000 credit line and they're never carrying more than $5,000 in the bank at any particular point, mathematically they can never pay you off. So all of a sudden this becomes something that you need to just, you know, kind of use, and we do a whole webinar, and maybe next time, Amanda, next year when I do a webinar for you guys, we can kind of teach everybody how to set credit lines, so I don't want to run too far down that. But you want to get the three trade references in the bank because it helps you set the credit lines. What it also does is if there's somebody that they start paying you slower, now, you and I both know that if they give you three people that they're paying, unless they're absolute morons, it's going to be companies that they're paying very well right now. But in 6 months, that may not be the case. If all of a sudden you see where they're paying you 2 to 3 weeks later than they should, dust off that credit application and go ahead and check the three trades in the bank. Also, that credit application, you can bury in there a personal guarantee where the owner signs for the company. You can bury the wording for, you know, being a secured creditor. If somebody would like a copy of our recommended kind of best practices credit application, email me and just put in the subject field free credit application and send it to me. My assistant will send you our best practices credit application. It's free of charge, and it has some of those special wordings on it. So if you had to sit down and say, okay, what do I need to do right now? Number one, if you think that you may remotely need to have access to capital in the next 2 or 3 years, right now, those COVID loans, nothing's going to be any cheaper. And under $200,000, they've waived the personal guarantees. The other thing I want you to do is to go and recheck your client's credit. If you already have a credit application, that's where you dust off and see how they're paying those other three trades. Then the third thing I want you to do is kind of categorize your clients in that A, B, and C. Yeah, still watch the A's and watch the B's a little bit. Where I'm most concerned about, the ones that are going to be most affected are going to be those C-size companies. And then I want you to, fourthly, pull an inventory of all of the documentation that you have. And lastly, set up some type of trigger that stops your invoices from continuing to grow. You know, if whatever that point of pain is, if you give somebody a $20,000 credit line and they approach $18,000, you probably want to go ahead and get them to pay shorter. So that kind of covers those items. I know that in our discussion, we had sent out, and there were some emails that were sent in with questions with some folks prior to it. Amanda, what were some of those questions? And I'll be happy to answer them. And right now, if you have any questions, by all means, please feel free to go ahead and jump into them. But what are some of the questions that were sent in?
The first question is related to the personal guarantee. I know a lot of staffing company owners ask, you know, how can they get a personal guarantee and to get the individual owners to be personally responsible for the sure. debt owed. Can you talk a little bit more about that? And is an owner of a small company automatically responsible for that personal guarantee, or does it depend upon the ownership type?
Sure. And first and foremost, most companies are either corporations or LLCs. And the only reason companies and LLCs originally started back in the 1600s, they were created to keep personal liability from off the owners of the people that were running the company. So if you're dealing with a LLC or a corporation, and you don't have a personal guarantee, if they shut down, the chances of being able to pop a corporate bail and go after the money are very slim. And even if you are able to pop the corporate bail, it's very expensive. The way to get around that is have the owner of the company, and I recommend anybody that's been in business less than 2 years, go ahead and sign the personal guarantee aspect. You can put it on the credit application. You know, there's an area where it basically, and I'm paraphrasing, but it basically says I singularly and severally guarantee the debt, and then they would put their name. Now, a little side note, make sure they put their name and they do not put a title. If they put a title, that gives them a defense to say, no, I really wasn't signing as John Smith. Personally, I was signing as John Smith, president or VP or whatever. Also, make sure that it's an owner or something along those lines. Occasionally, you'll send over this stuff and the bookkeeper or the credit manager or the HR manager will sign it. You know, it rarely will the judge give, if will give us a judgment against an HR manager, a collection manager that signed it, because they're going to argue they didn't know what they were signing. But even if they did, there typically aren't going to be any huge assets that you would be able to typically have with an owner. So an owner of the business. So make sure that it's somebody of authority that signs that personal guarantee. I always like the owners. Or the owner's wife, typically the owner, or if you have their CFO, if it's a larger company or an officer. But that's where I would use those. And on anybody that's under 2 years old, if they're, you know, here's the realistic expectations. The new businesses, 80% are going to fail in the first 5 years. And the ones that survive, the additional ones that survive, 80% of those are going to fail the following 5 years. The first 2 years, I mean, companies really just go through a pretty high burn rate. And if they're not willing to sign it personally and guarantee it, then why the heck would you be willing to guarantee their debt? Because that's exactly what you're doing. If they go out of business, you're not going to get paid.
And it's a good point, too, that, you know, if they are not credit worthy and you're trying to, you know, obtain some personal liability and they're unwilling to do it, that, you know, is a sign that you should be taking a look at as well, right? Just
100%.
Using, you know, what's around you to make a decision. If they're not willing to do it, it might be a flag. What are some of the biggest safeguards that you would suggest putting in a contract?
You know, in the contract, you can put in, you know, and when we ever say contract, a lot of people are really, you know, it's a big word. They don't want to, you know, I tell one of my daughters is our staff attorney. And if we're doing a deal for somebody, or if I'm doing a deal where we're acquiring a company or expanding on something and we have to bring her in, you know, one of the things I always pick with her is don't attorney it up. And anybody that's been on this call that's been in business for any amount of time, attorneys have killed more deals than ever. And so I realize that. So you don't necessarily want a, you know, 45-page contract, because you'll chase away more business and it will wind up affecting your top line and bottom line than anything else. But what I do recommend that you do is get a credit application signed, get a simple terms and agreement, and in there you can put the wording for becoming a secured creditor. You can also put a jurisdictional clause in there to where, you know, if you have to sue them, you can sue them in your state versus having to sue them in their state, which is in New York. Now, there's some nuances there where if you get a judgment, they don't have any assets, you still may have to sue them in their state. But if you had a temporary that did something amazingly stupid and they were going to come after you and sue you, I'd much rather be sued in my own backyard than to have to fly to New York to defend myself. So having a jurisdictional clause in there, having the personal guarantee clause, also having late fees and attorney's fees. You know, a lot of clients say, well, you know what, I want to be able to put attorney's fees. Well, if it's not in the contract, it's not going to happen. If it's in the contract, it's still at the court's discretion. And as a general rule, a third of our clients get those fees, a third of them get nothing, a third of them get somewhere in between. But if it's not in the contract, you absolutely have no chance whatsoever. And then also as far as on late fees and things on those lines, those are the things that you want to put in there just to where if things have to escalate up, you've got a chance at recovering some of those costs.
What's the typical time frame for recovery of funds after something has been sent to collections?
You know, as far as with us, you know, basically we're going to collect about 84% of the time if we don't have to sue. And we're going to collect that typically within about 30 days. There's exceptions to where you have maybe a 90-day payout. But about 70% of the time, we're going to have the funds in-house and collected in about 2 weeks' time from it being turned over. Now, if we have to sue them, on those, you know, one out of eight that our clients say, yep, let's go ahead and sue, then that's a much different process. That's about a 12-month process. But through the collection process, typically it's a 2 to 4 week once it's turned over and we've collected the funds.
How have debtors responded or performed in collections during the pandemic?
You know, that is a great question. And you know, when it first happened, you know, when we started going into lockdown, I, like everybody else on this call, was a little shocked. And, you know, we kind of looked at it and said, okay, what is this going to be? And what does this mean? And, you know, I've been through four recessions. I've never been through a pandemic. So I was as clueless as everybody else on what was going to happen. Here is the thing that shocked me. Our intake numbers, meaning new clients that are placing accounts, in the month of April and May basically got cut in half. So our new numbers coming in June and July, they returned to normal. But our revenues in May and June doubled, and then one of those months almost tripled. And it shocked me. And as we look at the numbers, what happened was the government dumped so much money into the system that a lot of debtors, you know, we had nursing homes, we had hospitals, we, you know, had manufacturing facilities, whoever was in for collections. They received so much cash where they were paying, you know, $10,000 a month on a $100,000 account. They just went ahead and paid it off. So the month of May, June, and July, the you know, the system had so much money in it that it actually improved cash flow. You know, interesting side note, during that same period of time, when we had, you know, what was it, 17%, 16%, whatever the maximum unemployment was, during those same months, everybody's credit on average actually improved by about 10 to 12 points. And so, you know, the national average of credit on personal FICO scores increased. And people actually had more money because the ones that were laid off on a lot of them, not all of them, but on a lot of these jobs, the frontline workers in the restaurant and hospitality industry are typically going to be, as a general rule, lower wage workers. Well, when they were getting the state unemployment plus the $600 a week bonus, they were actually making more money than when they were working. And the interesting thing about that is, you know, they paid down their credit, they went out and they bought, you know, all kinds of crazy stuff and all of that. So, during the pandemic, there's actually been more cash, and that is why I'm scared for 6 months, 9 months out, when all this cash that's in circulation starts getting systematically pulled out, then I think you're going to see businesses have to kind of struggle and have to you know, I'm from the South, so we'll always use really horrible, you know, expressions, and they always come back down to hunting or something along those lines. But they're going to have to eat what they kill. And right now, there's companies out there that are thriving because they've received, you know, $400,000, $500,000 in PPP. They reserved SBA loans, and then they saw a surge in their business because everybody else did as well. I live in Metro Atlanta. We were looking to have some work done at the house on some stuff, and it was literally double to triple the average price. a buddy of mine was looking at a pool, and they were telling them that it would be 12 to 18 months. I mean, some of them have stopped doing it, but the earliest they could get them in would be about 12 months out. So this has been a very weird pandemic. It's been very, you know, if you were a business owner, it's actually probably been pretty good. But I think those ramifications will start showing themselves once they start pulling the money back out of the system.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for covering all of this information for us. Do you have any final thoughts for the audience before we wrap up today's session?
You know, the only thing that I really would say is just focus on the fundamentals. I think that, you know, life is going to return to normal. Everybody's going to be probably a little over enthusiastic. And, you know, I'm not saying don't be enthusiastic. I'm certainly going to be the same way. But just don't let it blind you on just practicing good fundamentals. And just be careful when you extend out credit, because there's a lot of companies that have gone through a lot of money, but unfortunately, and who knows, there may be another stimulus that pushes this thing out, you know, another 90 days or something along those lines. But just be careful when you're extending credit. But the real danger zone to me from a credit standpoint is when we get on the other side of this pandemic and the government starts pulling that money back out of the system. So just be careful. And if you need us, certainly don't hesitate to give us a shout. I know we work with a lot of Tricom clients. We absolutely love them. And the reason we love them is because we collect at a higher percentage. Tricom clients are probably at about a 90, somewhere between an 89 and a 90% recovery rate. And that's not just because we love your clients. It's because you guys screen the clients. And so the clients, even if they've gone bad, at some point they were good. And so, you know, the ones that are heartbreaking are the ones where the client signs up a new, you know, manufacturing facility only to learn that they're the fourth staffing firm that hasn't been paid over the last 2 years, and now they're owed $50,000 to $100,000. So you guys do a lot of that pre-screening as well. But just be careful when you're extending out credit. And you know, on the next issue that you guys want to have me out, we'll drill down and spend more time on how to set and maintain credit lines.
That sounds great. Thank you. You know, and another point that you've mentioned in the top five is that stop sale, you know, pulling accounts or looking at risk and stopping continuing to service if they are not paying you or you are having struggles getting paid. Taking those warnings, it's very important to do it early and to continue your collection efforts. And if you're unable to strike a deal with the company, definitely turning the account over to Adams Evans Ross has been very beneficial for many of our clients. So I thank you for everything that you do for the industry and the information that you have shared with us today.
Well, certainly thank you. Everybody be safe. Have a good week. And hopefully we will see everybody out on the road again at the different conferences once life returns a little bit more to normal. But thank you, Amanda.
Sounds good. So thank you for joining us today. We'll go ahead and close out our session today, but watch for information on our next webinar session, and we will go ahead and post a recording of today's session on our website at tricom.com. It's under the Resources tab, and we hope to see you soon. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.